The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Blessed Lord, who has caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Well, hello, everyone. Some of you were here last week, but as a reminder, we are in Ecclesiastes. We are in Ecclesiastes and a bit of a broad overview, because we would need months to do a close reading. But the goal is that by the end of this class, this series, and if you can't make all of them, that's okay, we'll have them online, is that you might be more prepared to hear, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest, that is, really take in the book of Ecclesiastes. So that is our goal. So as a reminder, Ecclesiastes is a wisdom book, which means it is concerned with everything from everyday life to great cosmic questions of identity and purpose. So we are covering it all. And today we are doing a word study. Now, some of you will get really excited about a word study. I know some of you. I see you. And some of you are like, what are we going to do studying one word? So what I want us to think about is we are going to study a word that is at the heart of this book, that the teacher thinks is really important for the central message of Ecclesiastes. And the thing is, there's not agreement on how we translate this word. Now, that could make us worried, or we could see this as opportunity. And so our goal today is to see this as opportunity, an opportunity to wonder and to explore the text. Anna, my wonderful graduate assistant, just kidding. She's so much more than that, has handouts if you need one. But I want us to look at this one word and wonder what it might mean, what it has meant, and how it meaning different kind of variations of a theme can be meaningful to us in a variety of ways. So the word we are looking at today is havel. You will see in one of the quotes, it's sometimes spelled that B with a V because it's the soft pronunciation. There's also the doubled hard pronunciation of the B. But havel is how you pronounce that if you want to sound really smart talking to someone about what you learned today. So havel is the phrase you probably know from Ecclesiastes. And I want to go through some of the most popular readings of how this initial verse is translated. So every time you see here vanity, that is the word havel. In Hebrew, you have the effect of doubling, so it would be like havel, havel, says the teacher, havel, havel, like this real emphasis. So vanity of vanities, says the teacher. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. So this is the NRSV, our most commonly used translation. Academically, the most standard use, it is the translation that most Christian scriptures introductory courses use. You have the NIV. I grew up with the NIV. I don't know if it's some of your guys' old friends. But in NIV, we have a translation instead of vanity, meaningless. Meaningless, says the teacher. Utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. So this might be a little more resonant. It's hard to know what to do with the word vanity, but we do know what to do with the word meaningless. From the Message, I often use the Message. The Message isn't a technical translation because it's only done by one person, but it is a helpful way of seeing how Eugene Peterson, who knew the languages, tried to bring the text alive. And he translates Ecclesiastes 1:1 as smoke, nothing but smoke. That's what the questioner says. There's nothing to anything. It's all smoke. The Complete Jewish Bible, which is one of the standard Bibles for Jewish congregations, pointless, pointless, says Kohelet. Utterly meaningless. Nothing matters. Aren't we feeling great? Okay. Okay. Robert Alter, I've talked about Robert Alter before. Robert Alter, kind of like Eugene, has a one-person translation of the Hebrew Bible. It's in three volumes. Robert Alter was a huge influence on me because he reads the Bible as literature. And so he's very concerned with the literary prose of the translation. It's a beautiful translation. He has great notes. It's not a cheap volume, but it's a great volume if you ever want to get it. But he says, "Merest breath," said Kohelet. "Merest breath, all is mere breath." So you can see we have moved from meaninglessness and nothingness into smoke, and now we are getting into breath. Not exactly more uplifting, but maybe a little. And then we have the Kohelet translation, which is from this book. And this, Fish's biggest offering of this book, he's not the one that does the illustrations, it's Deborah Band, but his biggest offering is that he argues for a translation of this text, or this word, havel, as vapor. So kind of following in some ways Robert Alter, he says, "Vapor of vapors," says Kohelet. "Vapor of vapors, all is vapor." So we have many options. We have vanity, which is the common vanity of vanities. When you think the word vanity, what comes to mind? Self-absorbed, what'd you say, Kim? Vanity Fair, yes. Very nice. But to that, I think of someone looking in the mirror and kind of checking their hair. What else, vanity? Anything else come to mind? Superficial, surface level. Due credit, where it is. Yeah, there you go. So surface level, vain, self-focused, fashion, fashionista, looking good, maybe not much else there. Meaninglessness. I don't think I have to ask you what that one means. It is without purpose, without meaning. Smoke. When you read that as smoke from Eugene Peterson's, what do you think of? Of what? Of a fog, of something dense and hard to see through. Smoke and mirrors. Yeah, you're not getting a direct vision. It's an imperfect vision and maybe a misleading one. Good. I've got heard a couple over here at the same time. Disappears. It's fleeting. It's going to go away. And fleeting is a word that shows up a whole lot over and over again. What about breath? Mirrors. I clearly can't decide how to spell mirrors breath. What about breath? Halitosis. Okay. Yeah, Anna. Good. So this is a bit more neutral. Smoke has a bit more of negative connotations, which is interesting because in worship, smoke actually also has worshipful, but that's not where we go in our modern mindsets. Whereas breath is both fleeting, but also kind of necessary, kind of important. Having breath is a good thing, even if it is temporary and we are dependent on it. It's a more neutral term. Any other thoughts on breath? Yeah, less. A sigh, good. Which is maybe a fun way to read that of everything merest breath. It's you can almost hear the teacher taking a big old sigh. Like, here we are. It's pretty relatable. What about vapor, this kind of newer word? Do you like it? Do you have any smelling salts, vapors? Yes. So yes. I did not go there, Anna, but that is a place to go with vapor. What else? What when you think of vapor, what do you see? Nothing. Steam. It's before I wore glasses, I did not notice vapor as much. Now that I wear glasses, I notice vapor a whole lot. Especially when I open the oven to check on something and I get the whoosh. And then it dissipates. So that vapor is something sometimes invisible, sometimes present to us and then going away. I also think you get this here in Texas, but I think of being in the, I have this memory this very distinct memory of being in high school with a friend who had just learned how to drive, and she had a Camaro, which was very cool at the time. Maybe it's still cool, I don't know. I'm too far away from cool now. But it was very cool, and we were driving to a friend's cabin in the woods, because I'm Minnesotan, and that's what Minnesotans do. And we drive to cabins in the woods, and it was nighttime in the forest, and the fog was super thick. So thick that you couldn't see the front of the Camaro. And so I think of the way that vapor can be very small, like a boiling pot of water, or also the way that water can create this atmosphere that's really kind of like smoke, in that it's dense and hard to see. There are levels of what we understand as vapor. Moving more broadly in scripture, the rest of these will be NRSV translation, just for standard, but where else we see, I did a little word study for you, where else we see this word. This is one of many. I have a list. If you want me, email me and I'll send you the list of where else I see this. But we see Havel sometimes translated as idol or idols. So in Deuteronomy, they made me jealous with what is no God, provoked me with their idols. And this translation of Havel as idol shows up a lot in terms of idolatry. You see it in Kings, you see it in Jeremiah. It's a kind of a repetitive, places where they talk a lot about idolatry, you find this word showing up of Havel, which might be surprising, because when we think of vanity of vanities, meaningless, we don't necessarily think of idolatry, but that is one way that this goes. In Isaiah, we see it as worthless, more familiar, for Egypt's help is worthless and empty. The other thing to notice about Havel is it's often paired with words like fleeting or emptiness, kind of as a complement to that, and it draws out some of that meaning, and the translator makes choices to draw out that kind of double emphasis. So here we have both worthless, followed by a word for empty. In Isaiah 49, but I said, I have labored in vain, I have spent my strength for nothing, and vanity. So you see that there's other words also that sub in for Havel. So it's again used as emphasis and emphasizing nothingness. This also shows up in Jeremiah, this both worthless and nothing translation. Again in Isaiah, you have the language of breath, which we've talked about. When you cry out, let your collection of idols deliver you. The wind will carry them off. A breath will take them away. Here we have the language of breath, but it's also paired with speaking out against idolatry. You have in Jeremiah, for the customs of the people are false. So here you have a very clear negative language, and false or lies also shows up in Jeremiah 16:9, that Havel is not nothingness, it is falsehood and it is lies, tied in with that idea of idolatry. And Zechariah, we are told, for the teraphim, that is the household gods, some of you know the history of the household gods, utter nonsense, and the diviners see lies. The dreamers tell false dreams and give empty consolation. Here, emptiness is again Havel. Havel also shows up in Job 35, using the same connotation of emptiness. This is why I gave you a handout, because I know it's a lot, but I think it's helpful to see these at work. In the Psalter, you have made my days a few handbreadths, and my lifetime is as nothing in your sight. Surely everyone stands as a mere breath. So here it's translated as breath, but then it shows up again. Surely everyone goes about like a shadow. Surely for nothing, they are in turmoil. They head up and do not know who will gather. So here you have the double use of Havel, one as speaking about what it means to be human, and one talking about the human's work, used both in one verse. You also have in the Psalms a number of times, and in Job, this translation in the NRSV of Havel as breath. And then in Job 9, Havel shows up a lot, as we can see. I shall be condemned, why then do I labor in vain? And here it's similar to the surely for nothing, but it's kind of the translator is trying to emphasize the vanity, the surface level meaninglessness of it. So adding to what we see in the different translations of Havel and Ecclesiastes, we see more broadly how the NRSV also ties us to idolatry, things being worthless, even nothing or no thing, emptiness, breath again, and being in vain, not just vanity. Okay, so Havel can mean two things. Havel can be in the strand of nothingness, of worthlessness, of emptiness. This is where idolatry would fit in. What is someone, what is an idol but a false god, a no thing? It is just another object among many. Or you can go to the place of transience, of things being fleeting and breath and vapor. I forgot a slide, so I need to figure out where I'm going to insert in a comment, but we'll get there. So, you know, don't you teachers hate that when you're like teaching, you're like, I knew I forgot something. So this is our man, Fish. He says, and this is his argument for vapor, being a discourse on possible human achievement and the limits of human wisdom, rather than on the value or viability of other gods, it makes much better sense to attribute to Kohelet the notion of Havel consistently reserved by the Hebrew Bible to human transience than to attribute to it what is reserved for the senselessness and vacuity of idol worship. So he is saying, how do we know how we should translate Havel in Ecclesiastes? We look at the book. We kind of step back from this one-word translation and look at what this book is concerned with. This book is very much concerned with the human condition, with what human work is worth, with what it ends us up with kind of existence. It is not so much about God and God's idols. It is not so much about alternatives. It is much more existential, we would say. And because of that, it makes more sense, he argues, to go the way of transience rather than nothingness, which is why he very intentionally chooses the word vapor, because what is more transient and fleeting than vapor? It also means that this isn't about nothing being worth our time being human and our toil being worth nothing. Instead, it's about our toil being fleeting. It's limited in time and space, which is where we get the subtitle for this book and for this class, Searching for a Life Worth Living. What kind of life is worth living in our transience and in our fleetingness? Does that distinction make sense? Any thoughts on that initially? Yes, Glenn. Yeah. Well, when I asked, that's a good question. So Glenn asked, where does vanity fall in here? Vanity, I think our initial instinct in some of what we said was emptiness, because it's shallow and it's reserved. But you could also, to defend NRSV, vanity could be something, those of us that are aging and things are changing in our body, could also be a reminder in our vanity that life is fleeting and temporal and we are limited by time. So I think there is a way for vanity to cover either of these depending on the angle that we come at it. Brett? Yeah. 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 Yeah, so I think Fish's argument is if, I know at least one person in this room did their homework, if you were to read all of Ecclesiastes in one sitting, what sits with you more? The human condition as being limited in time and space, or our work being worth nothing? If you were to kind of dull that one word, Havel, from showing up, and Fish's argument, if you were to do that, it kind of it pushes us, the book lends itself to be more about human toil, human work, we're all going to die, things come and they go, more than it all being pointless. And Brian, when he teaches in 2 weeks, will talk about, I think, some of why it allows this positive end. I'm guessing he's going to do this. He's not in here right now. We'll see. Why it's not fake that the teacher ends on a positive note. Because it's not about undoing everything that's been said. It's about the fact that we are transient, and yet God is constant. the slide. Oh, yeah, Brian, go ahead. Folly. Yeah. 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 Good. Yeah, so vanity. Yeah. The choice of the translator is very significant to the passage. Yes, Brian. But that is not meant to cause you anxiety. What it does do, y'all don't need to learn Hebrew. I mean, it's beautiful and wonderful and hard and amazing. But you don't need to learn Hebrew. What I would highly recommend is that you make friends with Bible Gateway or Bible.com or buy yourself the NRSV, the KJV, the Message, maybe that Robert Alter. And when you get to passages where you're like, vanity of vanities, that's a weird phrase, you open up some of these other translations to show you the range for some of these words, that I think that's helpful. Anna Lauren and then Bill. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Good. That's right, and that is why in whoever planned this series to be during Len's genius, we begin Ash Wednesday with "You are dust, and to dust you will return," right? That there's, in this season of being reminded that we are not God, that we are human, that we are born and we will die, we have this reminder of transience, which is a theological claim and not just an existential one. We are not gods, which is, I think, why this word is very related in this way. Bill. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, me and Les could riff on the narcissism and the Jesus way as we look to Ecclesiastes, and I'm sure I offer this to you if you haven't already, which maybe you have, but it's an interesting way to see the narcissist thinks they are something other than transient. They are lying to themselves about who they are, and the teacher is saying to them, no, man, all of this is going to go away. You can try to cling to it, but good luck with that, is really what. And even, to Brian's point, even our wisdom is still fleeting. Even if it isn't folly, it's still human wisdom. Like, keep yourselves in check about what you think you're doing here. I saw one other hand. Yes, Janine. We will get there. Yeah. So our last session will be bringing Ecclesiastes to the good news of the gospel through the lens of Christ. And I already was starting to do it, the ways that this, because we've talked about this before, how the Hebrew Bible was translated into Greek, the Septuagint, which means that we have some ways to see the way the move from the Hebrew to the Greek was adopted. And because then we have that, we can then move a word like havel through the Greek to the New Testament and be like, does it show up kind of in the same way? So we will get there. I'm anticipating you. Yes, Chris. Yeah. Mm. Chris. So the question is this book the most rigorous treatment of time in the Bible? That is a great question. I think, at least philosophically, probably yes. I think you have other ways that time gets talked about, including Anna Lauren, she might have snuck away, including that kind of the great temptation of kind of defying our limits. But yeah, I think that this is a good temper about how we are to understand ourselves as beings in time. The slide I forgot, but I wonder if I can, let's see, how fancy can I get? This is going to be a disaster, but we're going to do it. Okay. Can you see that? Oh, boy. It's hard to do this. This word is kavod. Wow, she's beautiful. This word is kavod. So if havel is meant to emphasize something of transience, of temporality, of fleetingness, there is a complement word. Does anyone know what kavod is? Any Hebrew scholars in the room? Any of your seminary or undergrad training? Kavod is used a lot in the Pentateuch and into the history of talking about the weightiness of God's presence, the glory of God. This is when we hear about the glory of God descending on the tabernacle, or after Solomon's prayer of dedication, descending on the temple. It is speaking of the kavod, God's glory. And God's glory is weighty. It is something that brings with it like a solidity that doesn't totally make sense, but that really rests. And so to Chris's point about a theological reflection on time, this word havel is transient, is up against this other theological picture of who is God. God is weighty. Often we make God this angelic being. God is an angel. God is the very substance of existence, the very means of us doing anything and everything. And Hebrew has a way of talking about knowing that God is present by the weight of it. You even see in Pentecost, you know, the flames coming down into the room. It's that same picture of something coming down that is substantial, that doesn't totally make sense, but is substantial and weighty. And I think that in the back of the teacher's mind is this picture of we are not that. We are not kavod. We are not glory. We are not God's weight descending. Doesn't mean we are without value, but if we think that we are weighty like God is weighty, we have this all wrong about who we are. Okay, so forgive me for that slide. So in this book, we have the illustrations I talked about that are at Art Center Waco right now, and this is one of them that I really like. So she'll have, the way that it works is on either side of the page, you'll have the Hebrew and the English. So it's Hebrew, because Hebrew is read this way, and English is read this way, so they come together in the middle. And you have Hebrew and English of the same reflections with illustrations that sometimes mirror each other, sometimes play off each other. But here you have, she writes this in the Hebrew and in the English. This is also a vapor and a striving after wind, which is one of these key phrases from Ecclesiastes. And the thing I like about it, one, in a bunch of these images, they have this kind of, some of the text in this circular pattern that's meant to evoke the vapor. But even you see the tree, and we're meant to see this kind of dancing of the word havel, of vapor. On the other side of the page, it's the actual Hebrew, of this dancing of how we are meant to see what it means that all is havel. All is fleeting, all is vapor. And so this is a way, if you were to look at these images, that she's inviting you in to seeing how this works. Okay, so on your handout, this is what we're doing for the end of class. You have Ecclesiastes 1 through 11. And what I want us to do, I want us to read this, but I want us to read this with Havel being kind of open rather than the rest. So you have NRSV minus the Havel. But this is the first verse, or the second verse is the framing for the rest of everything that happens. So the words of the teacher, the son of David, king in Jerusalem, Havel of Havel, says the teacher. Havel of Havel, all is Havel. And then you continue. What do people gain from all the toil at which they toil under the sun? A generation goes and a generation comes, but the earth remains forever. The sun rises and the sun goes down and hurries to the place where it rises. The winds blow to the south and goes around to the north. Round and round goes the wind, and on its circuits the wind returns. All streams run to the sea, but the sea is not full. To the place where the streams flow, there they continue to flow. All things are wearisome, more than one can express. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, or the ear filled with hearing. What has been is what will be, and what has been is what will be done. There is nothing new under the sun. Is there a thing of which it is said, "See, this is new"? It has already been done in the ages before us. The people of long ago are not remembered, nor will there be any remembrance of people yet to come by those who come after them. So my question for you is, knowing that Havel has this range of meaning, as it sets up this kind of well-known early reflection of the teacher, what does it change knowing that there is a range? Does that question make sense? How do you read the rest of this opening pericope, which is a small section of scripture? How does it change your reading knowing that it doesn't necessarily mean the one thing you always had in your head that it must mean? Yeah, Julie. Yeah. It alleviates the pressure. This is like talking about time, Chris. Ecclesiastes is like brutal in terms of looking at our own existence. And knowing that there is room for us to wonder about what the teacher could be saying to us that doesn't feel so nihilistic or deterministic or hopeless kind of gives us some breathing room about what might be going on from the teacher in this passage. Yeah, Dan. Yeah. It's all fleeting nothingness.
But it seems more now the purpose of this kind of opening refrain is to kind of create this contrast, right? That the end goal of it is essentially sort of humility.
Good.
Like, hey, not as important in the center of the universe as you think.
Yeah.
There's all this other stuff that is quite permanent, right?
Yeah. You need
a. You're much more vapor.
Yeah, you're much more. Yeah.
So, not saying you're worthless, not saying everything's meaningless, but you're a little closer to vapor than the ocean.
Okay, good. So it's the shifting from nihilism, or like you are a piece of crap worth nothing, why even try, to more of a let's be honest and let's be humble about who we are. The oceans and the sun and even the wind is going to outlive you. We don't remember what our great-great-grandparents did. We don't, like, get over yourself. That doesn't mean you're worth nothing, but it does mean you're not everything, right? This kind of shifting. I saw Chris and then Jason and then Anna and then Alan. I'm going to remember all that. Good. Yeah. Good. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, an anti-narcissistic bend, and I'll look to our rhetoricians over here. There's also this, the world is already fleeting and changing, and you're just this tiny part. I don't know if that's, I'm getting little nods. That if this is true of the entire world, and you're just one little person, that there's this kind of emphasis on human fleetingness. You may think yourself much better than the ocean, but let's be clear about how this works. Jason. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good. So I don't. That's a really good point, Jason, because we mentioned a bit about the discomfort both by Jews and Christians with the inclusion of Ecclesiastes into the canon because it felt very secular. But without the theological underpinning and close of this book, Ecclesiastes probably wouldn't belong in the canon. It's because all of this is rooted and the truth of a God who created all these things, sustains and brings to completion all of these things, that all of this other stuff is in fact a theological claim and not just a secular one about the human and the pointlessness and futility. That it's rooted in a theological belief that God is God and we are not. But that also God hates nothing he has made, right? That we get from that Ash Wednesday prayer. Alan. No, Alan Jones. False vanity. Yeah. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. Yeah.
So there is continuous and transient in this that is not just the end of all things.
Good.
And that's where I think, because I can look at this and go, well, they know it all.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, I think, and yes, so there's a comfort and a reassurance in this that isn't, I think, about the narcissistic tendency so much as it is about, like, I can't do this. I can't do this. And there's actually a comfort in, you're not supposed to do all of this. Like, yeah, it's going to be okay. And for, like, I hear you that for me, it's like, it lets you off the hook of feeling like you need to do anything more than this way that you have been called in this moment. Jeff, yeah.
When I see the smoke, I think of Bill Cosby talking about being in a dentist chair and seeing smoke coming from his mouth. He has a great description of smoke, fire.
Yeah. Yeah.
But just the way he describes being in that, you know, dentist office and there's smoke coming out. Oh, no.
Yeah, it's smoke is the kind of thing we will maybe not allude to the teller of that story for various reasons, but smoke is not an alarming thing. Yeah. Smoke is not an alarming thing as alarming unless it's in your immediate vicinity. And that this is bringing it into your immediate vicinity. This is bringing that. This is not an out there smoke sign. This is a you. Yeah, you. Havel, Havel. Was there something? I don't know if there's someone over here. I didn't want to. Yes, Brian.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's really good. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so vanity is like willful. It's a choice. Being transient, good luck not being that, right? That it definitely, and I think for our third Advent Soup Supper, Garrett's going to talk a bit about how we try to defy death, that's what makes us monstrous, because it's just not possible. It's only going to pervert things in this attempt. That this becomes much more at the root of ourselves rather than just don't do that. I think that's good. This isn't a book of ethics. This is a book of essence. All right. Yeah, Jesse.
When I was in high school back in the day,
Dust in the wind. Yeah. 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 No, I think in the Old Testament there's still that tension that you have been created with intention and purpose, and you are an image bearer of the God of all time and all existence, but you're also dust. That there seems to be both are true, and neither one is negated by the other. So I just thought of, and I, you know, those horrible videos of someone like, oh, there was, which show had it? Of those going out to sea with the ashes, and then they go to dump it, and it flies back in their face. Anyway, I wouldn't do that level of crassness, but I think the teacher would kind of like that video. Like, you start taking yourself too seriously or thinking you need to carry too much, remember, you might just fly back in someone's face someday. And that is true. That being true doesn't mean we aren't of value. Doesn't mean that we aren't with intention, but it doesn't undo that we are dust. In the great fullness of time and eternity, we will still be dust. We will just be redeemed and resurrected dust. And so we never will be a God. We will just be a God upheld and sustained through the life and love of the triune God. So I don't want to say your mom is wrong, but I do want to say you don't have to choose one. I think if we choose one, we're tipping. We're tipping too far one way or the other. Anna, yeah, it might be the final question. Yeah. 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 It's exhausting. So this is, if some of you have asked me like what I'm giving up for Lent, and I often don't give anything up for Lent, and it's for this reason, that Lent is supposed to remind us that we are dust. But pick something because it'll be a good reminder. I might even go further than Aaron. I might say if your life right now is defined by striving, I don't think you should give anything up for Lent. I think you should figure out some way in Lent to help you do the opposite of striving. And I think that as someone who has been in the grind of that striving before, being reminded that I fail at it is not exactly what I needed in that moment. But what I did need is maybe what you take on is something like restfulness or drawing if you're really bad at it or really good at it, or baking if you're really bad at it or good at it, or taking naps or doing things that push against that impulse that you have to be all things at all times. And that might seem contrary to like fasting, but you're fasting from the things that make you forgetful about who you are before God. And so fasting can be taking something on if it helps remind you of who you are before God. So, and for some of us, there are things we need to give up that get in the way of that. And for some of us, I think there are things we need to take on. Or maybe with your BFF or spouse, you can just point at them and say, Havel, Havel! No, don't do that. When they think they're really proud of themselves for accomplishment, be like, it's all fleeting. Okay. I'm going to pray for us. Next week, we will be doing Ecclesiastes 3, turn. That'll be our kind of close reading week where we'll spend some time really in the text, which you guys know that I love to do, and so I wanted to make sure we did that at least once. So let me pray for us. God, thank you that you are the one in your weighty glory that roots us, gives us purpose and meaning. Help us do everything we do with an eye to the fact that you are the one that gives us value and purpose and brings all things to a good end. Amen.